Thank you so much, Glenna. I really have to thank, of course, Glut1 Foundation and Matthew's friends to be here. It's an honor. I find this meeting is really astonishing and allows us to get together and talk about all possible therapies for ketogenic diets. So I've been going to give you a little background of how we got to the point of studying ketone ester on epilepsy and similar pathologies like Glut1. I've been working with Dr. DiAgostino and Dr. Dean at University of South Florida in Tampa for 3.5 years on the ground with these guys who are from the Office of Naval Research, the U.S. Navy. What do these guys do? Well, they have attack mission, defense mission, submarine rescue missions, and in all this, they have a big issue, the fact that they can have seizures while diving at 100% oxygen. So I just wanted to show you what we call the gas palace. It's basically a tank farm where we could reproduce any sort of diving conditions, but with rats. So basically, we started diving rats. So what is a central nervous system oxygen toxicity? What kind of seizure do we have, and how do we? How do this happen? Well. Oxygen toxicity can be generated in two main ways. One is hyperbaric oxygen treatment. The other one is breathing with a rebreather. So during particular hard missions, we need to be stealth, so no bubbles. And thus, we use 100% oxygen in gas mixes. So how many of you are divers? Is there any diver in there? Oh, we have like very, very few. Okay, but that's good. Definitely, if we increase the amount of oxygen in our tank and we increase the pressure, we have high risk of seizing. Now, if this happens in a hyperbaric chamber, okay, it's feasible to reverse it. But if this happens under the water, death is almost sure. So the Navy actually wanted us to find a way to prevent seizure to happen because they were losing a lot of Navy SEALs. And for some of you that might be curious about what seizure might look like under the water, here we have someone breathing 100% oxygen, whereas this one is breathing just air at 2.8 atmospheres. So see what happens. Now he's feeling dizzy and he's asking his physician to take off the mask. And now, so the physician takes off his mask, and see, now he's laying down. And you're gonna see all of a sudden him seizing if you look at his feet. So this is what looks like seizing under the water. Now, again, in a hyperbaric chamber, this is okay, it's not a big deal. But when this happens under the water, that is under the corner. So see, now he's seizing right now. So his unconsciousness, he loses consciousness now, and well, this is going to last for about 3.5 minutes. So our lab started working on solitary complex neurons, neurons responsible for respiration. They started off about 10 years ago working on brainstem neurons, doing electrophysiology. And Dr. DiAgostino was one of the project leaders on that. And they found out that in any hyperbaric oxygen stimulation, the neurons would be excited. Also, they found out the neurons that were highly responsive for hyperbaric oxygen were also highly responsive for carbon dioxide. So now the Navy wanted us to put all this in an in vivo model and compare this with a live animal and see what were at the time the physiological parameters happening or changing right before the onset of seizure, so we can predict that onset of seizure. So we implanted our Sprague-Dawley rats with these devices here on top right. These devices are called radio telemetry. Basically, they're able to tell us in real time electroencephalogram data, electrocardiogram data, electromyogram data, physical activity, and body temperature. So once we implanted them, like after a week, the animal was totally fine and up and running, and we were able to dive the animal into this chamber using this receiver. The receiver was connected to a computer, so communicating the data straight to the computer so we could record all the physiological parameters before the dive, during the dive, and after the dive, so right after, before the seizure. And this is what a seizure in a rat looks like. So as you can see, he's gonna sit on his back paws and he's gonna seize. Basically, he has tonic-clonic movements of four limb and head. So we had visual and electronic data. So this is like a typical trace of what we found out. So you can see here we have electroencephalogram here. We have electromyogram here for the respiration and electrocardiogram. What we found out in the end was that 3 to 5 minutes before the onset of seizures, we were able to record a considerable increase in tidal volume, which is the volume that the rat was breathing, and the frequency of respiration he was having. So 3 to 5, sometimes even 8 minutes before the onset of seizure, we were able to predict that onset of seizure. So as Dr. D'Agostino described yesterday, the Navy was willing to also find a solution for that, not only to predict, also to prevent. So regular strategists would suggest as antioxidants, anti-epileptic drugs, or there's also a lot of research about hyperoxic preconditioning, but Dr. D'Agostino went on the path of starvation. And this was our hypothesis. So if it works against epilepsy, why wouldn't it work against CNS oxygen toxicity? So of course, we were following the path of increase of blood acetone, decrease of reactive oxygen species, and increase of energy reserves. So this is the kind of mechanism we were following. But can you imagine putting a Navy SEAL on a ketogenic diet during such a stressful period? I mean, it's kind of hard. So Dr. D'Agostino had the idea of in synthesizing the ketone ester that would increase the amount of blood ketones immediately. So we realized that after gavaging, so intragastrically administering the rats with a small dose of ketone ester, we were able to get a 574% increase in resistance against the seizures. Basically, 30 minutes before the dive, we would give them intragastrically a small dose of ketone ester. That would suffice, that would be enough to let the rat go 6 times longer in average. Not only, actually, we gave them 2 different types of esters. We gave them butanediol and ketone ester. Now, both of them increased beta-hydroxybutyrate. So we wanted to find out what was the real responsible for this resistance, this increase in resistance. Beta-hydroxybutyrate was increased in both cases. Acetoacetate was increased in both cases, but ketone ester actually made it skyrocket immediately. Whereas acetone, which we believe to be one of the main responsible for the anti-epileptic action, only went up when we administer ketone ester, not butanediol. And glucose in this graph here was not affected. So we also had data on pH, actually found out that both compounds would decrease their blood pH, but just slightly. So yes, it's true, it was a significant number here, but from an homeostatical point of view, it didn't change very much. So back to the second part of this talk, I found a job in my hometown, and after 13 and a half years, I decided to go back to Italy. And I go back to Italy, of course, I love ketogenic diets and all the environment of ketosis, and I tried to find someone that would collaborate on that, because we still have our ketone ester that we wanted to test. So I find this nice group of neurologists, Dr. Coppola and Dr. Vigiano, who were willing to test our ketone ester on a different model of epilepsy, because so far we had been testing only the ketone ester on CNS oxygen toxicity. So other than Dr. Coppola and Dr. Vigiano, I, of course, had the help of two companies. One you probably know, of course, it's Solus Nutrition with Keto Cuisine. They were so kind to send over Italy 200 bags of keto flour. So I could distribute this to patients, GLUT1 patients, epileptic patients, and also friends. So we were able to produce a lot of recipes, of carb-free recipes, and put them online. And this other company, Le Gamberi Ketogenic Food, which is actually the only company nowadays in Italy that is able to make bread, pasta, pizza, Nutella, chocolate, cookies of all types, which are very palatable, same taste, but they have a very, very low amount of carbohydrates, if nothing. So we started working with patients, and we were so lucky to participate to this campaign, Love Someone with GLUT1. And as you can see here, I had my colleagues being involved in this project, so we could distribute information, products, recipes, flour, and all these kind of things to patients who needed them. So back to the data. We wanted to know if this ketonester that we had proven to be effective against seizure due to CNS oxygen toxicity was also effective against seizure due to pentylenethrazole. Now, why pentylenethrazole? Because pentylenethrazole has been used for several years as a standard for generating seizures artificially. So it's an agent that, when injected, is able to, according to the dose, of course, is able to generate epileptic seizures in minutes or even in seconds. So what we found, well, this was our protocol. So basically, the rats were able to eat any sort of food they wanted. There was no restriction. The only restriction we had in the protocol was that last time they could eat was at 4 p.m. the day before the experiment. So we had them standardized, at least on the fasting protocol. It was like semi-fasting protocol. But we then calculated their blood ketosis, blood glucose, and two hours after that, we injected pentylenethrazole. So we had basically two groups. And what we found out, before I can give you the data, is that the two groups were actually very similar. As you can see in this table, they didn't differ in terms of weight. They didn't differ in terms of ketosis before the experiment. They didn't differ in terms of blood glucose. The only thing they were different, of course, was the blood ketosis after the administration of the ketonester, as we had already proven when we did the first study. So this is also a correction factor because, of course, every rat has a different weight. So we had to calculate their body mass in order to give them the right dose of uretane to anesthetize them. So this is the big shot. So we were able to find out that seizure-wise, the ketonester was able to revert the epileptic condition even in a pentylenethrazole model, which is a very big step if we consider that pentylenethrazole is the standard for generating seizures in animals. So just to make the point of the situation, the take-home message is that with ketonesters, we were able to elevate beta-hydroxybutyrate, acetoacetate, and acetone. Of course, the latency to seizure was increased in the first study of about six times after gavaging the rats with the ketonester. So with a regular diet, no carbohydrate restriction, no calorie restriction. That worked very well also in a pentylenethrazole model. And what we have now online is to continue doing the study in chronic, because all we did was in acute. But we want to see if giving them like a regular dose of ketonester every day for at least 10 days would generate any sort of beneficial effect. Of course, the final aim of our research is to generate a ketogenic diet in a pill. This would bypass a lot of problems that people are encountering with the compliance, the diets. So I'm just giving you an update of what's going on in Italy, because Italy is still a country that needs a lot of information. We don't have such a developed network in terms of GLUT1, in terms of ketogenic diet for epilepsy, or even cancer. Actually, cancer is another big problem. So what's going on right now is that we're going to try the keto salts. It's a hydrosoluble version of the keto ester from Dr. DiAgostino's lab. We're going to try this like within the next month. Also, we would like to get some GLUT1 knockout mice in order to test them in the lab in Salerno in Italy. And on the way, actually, there are two clinical trials with 600 epileptic patients that will be treated within the next month in the hospital San Lorenzo in Salerno with the modified Atkins diet, thanks to Dr. Coppola and Dr. Cusano, my colleagues, and 40 Parkinson patients that will be administered a 4-to-1 ratio ketogenic diet in Rome. So this is what it's on the list, but we're kind of far away from a bureaucratic perspective. We need some time for documents. So the very last project is what I've been following as soon as I go back to my hometown, which is Benevento. These are some pictures from there, with the service of oncology. I went talking to the chief of the oncology ward, you know, asking him if he was willing to put some patients, some oncology patients, on a ketogenic diet, because at least inform them that there is an alternative way to chemotherapy and radiotherapy. He was totally willing to do so. Although, well, this is just a few information, and Dr. Seifried is going to, of course, talk about this after me. All comes from the Werber theory, and the question is cancer a metabolic disease? Well, according to the Werber theory, 90 to 95% of cancer are environmental, whereas only 5 to 10% are due to genetics. There are also a very neat paper from Dr. Seifried published in 2003 in which he declared, actually he demonstrated, that blood glucose drives tumor growth. And Stafford in 2010 demonstrated that if we put animals that have cancer, stage 4, on a ketogenic diet, they can survive more. So they have a better quality of life and a longer life. So, and this is a very well-known case. I'm sure Dr. Seifried will talk about this later. This is Dr. Giulio Zuccoli's mother case. It's a clinical case in which this lady had a glioblastoma multiforme, as you can see in the picture on the right-hand side. And then, after being on ketosis, so after reaching the metabolic zone, a few months later, the glioblastoma was gone. So these are just some publications, some cases, but there are so many more that came out after that and will come out. Personally, I can say that I talk to people, and when they have no other choice, they still would like to try this. And so I address them mostly to Professor Tagliabue in Northern Italy. She's helping out with these cases of cancer because we don't have an established system that can cure patients with a ketogenic diet if they have cancer or not in Italy. So this is another paper from our lab. Dr. Poff, Dr. DiAgostino published that they basically said that ketogenic diet and hyperbaric oxygen combination prolonged the survival in mice with metastatic cancer in this VMM3 model. So there are many cases that support the evidence that, of course, ketogenic diet is very effective against cancer. So this is what we are doing right now. We are recruiting. It's a small number, I know, but that's something good to start. Dr. Febraro, the chief of the oncology ward, started recruiting people for breast cancer. And why breast cancer? Because breast cancer is the more standardizable one, at least where we are. So we can have patients more or less the same age with the same problems, and we're going to try to, we're going to actually put them on a 90-day ketogenic diet when they stop from one cycle and the next one, chemotherapy. So we also provide them with surveys, and we want to know how they feel after the trial. So, and this is the very last thing I wanted to, you know, I wanted to ask you to concentrate on. It's a movie. I love this movie. It's a movie came out in the United States, Fed Up, May 2014. It's not many months ago, but this movie basically tried to tell America how bad sugar is. Now, not that America is the only affected country, but But this is very important to know. I realized coming here that many people from the States had heard of it but hadn't watched it. So I just wanted to put the attention on this trailer, and it's just two and a half minutes, but I want you to know that there is a common opinion that sugar is definitely bad, and not all kind of sugar, especially high fructose corn syrup. But I think this is important.
The epidemic here is worse than previously estimated, much worse.
The message that's been pushed on us, it's your fault you're fat.
Shouldn't be so hard to get them to run around and play, right?
They have voracious appetites and they don't exercise enough.
It's about how active our kids are.
Forget about it. There are 600,000 food items in America. 80% of them have added sugar.
Your brain lights up with sugar just like it does with cocaine or heroin. You're going to become an addict.
You end up with one of the great public health epidemics of our time.
This is the first generation of American children expected to lead shorter lives than their parents.
I am 12 years old, and my doctors have said that I am a statistic.
We're blaming willpower, and it's a crime.
Over 95% of all Americans will be overweight or obese in two decades.
We're toast as a country.
The sugar industry is extraordinarily powerful. They're in business to make money, not to keep America healthy.
What if our whole approach to this epidemic has been dead wrong?
The government is subsidizing the obesity epidemic.
We place private profit ahead of public health. Systematic political failure.
By 2050, one out of every three Americans will have diabetes.
Those diseases are being driven by sugar.
This is the fundamental problem nobody's talking about in society.
We could cure 80% of the problem where they prepared the food in the school.
Tomato paste is a vegetable? Really?
Junk food companies are acting very much like tobacco companies did 30 years ago.
I would reject entirely any argument that they are in any way harmful.
Lying through their teeth.
Kids are being told the biggest lie they will ever hear in their lives.
Ronald McDonald never sells to children. He informs and inspires through magic and fun.
If a foreign nation were doing that to our children, we would defend our families.
Years from now, we're going to say, I can't believe we let them get away with that.
You have to change the diet of America.
It's all preventable.
And I'm pretty sure you guys are going to watch. Those who haven't watched it might be curious at this point. But so I just wanted to especially thank Glut One Foundation, the Italian Glut One Foundation, who's growing and growing. For the first time, we were able to meet last month. Of course, Madison Stoddard, who came over from Glut One Foundation, from actually MIT in Boston, helped us with some work. My colleagues, of course, Glenna. As I was telling you, this was the first official meeting of Glut One Foundation. So we are definitely growing. I'm happy about that. This is my old lab, and I'm really thankful to them to getting me started on this path. And thank you so much for your attention.